Whole StoryQuest Audiobooks presents Deluded by M.A. Comley, narrated by Louise Amos. Prologue. Tina Webb's heart leapt with joy. It had been a while since she, Malcolm, and the children had spent any real quality time together in the past few months, due to their obscene workload. Malcolm had just started up a steam cleaning business, and she was helping him by answering the phone and being his general dog's body, otherwise known as his secretary where his accountant and the taxman were concerned. It was tough embarking on the self-employed journey. Neither of them had gone down this route before. They'd always worked for large companies. Malcolm used to be a lorry driver, delivering goods for Marks and Spencer, and Tina used to work at a factory making Kipling cakes. She'd hated it, doing a mind-numbing job on the production line. She had endured the mundane role for years only because they needed the money. The upside was she got on so well with the rest of the staff. She missed them dearly. But this was it now, the beginning of a new adventure for both of them, with the added bonus that she wouldn't have to rely on her mum any longer to care for the kids after school. Tallulah and Marcus were just as excited as her and Malcolm. So here they were, up on the Brecon Beacons, Malcolm carrying the bulging picnic basket, and the kids running around them teasing Jasper, the black and white cocker spaniel. "Happy?" Malcolm asked. Tina pecked him on the lips. "Deliriously so. I don't think I've ever been so happy. Well, except when we walked down the aisle, and the day I gave birth to the kids. Oh, and when I got that promotion at work." Malcolm tipped his head back and laughed. "You're nuts." "I know, but you still love me, right?" He stopped beside her, placed the picnic basket on the ground and pulled her into his arms. "More than ever. I'd be lost without you in my life, Tina." She kissed him again.
"Yuck, get a room, you two," Marcus shouted.
Tina turned to look at him and chuckled. His blonde curls bounced in the breeze. She loved her family so much. Other mothers spent most of their time at the factory complaining about what their kids got up to. She'd never done that, because in her eyes, Tallulah and Marcus were perfect in every way. They never fought, always played nicely together. Even settled down on the couch, they snuggled up to each other, often with Jasper sitting close beside them. Tina expelled a satisfied breath. "Oh, I'm so lucky to have you all in my life." Malcolm slipped an arm around her shoulders and kissed the top of her head. "We're the lucky ones. Our business would still be a dream if you hadn't chucked your job in to help out. I know it's going to be a struggle for us over the next year or so, but I truly appreciate the sacrifices you've made." "Nonsense. So we forgo our holiday this year, and the money we've put aside for that will pay the bills until the business takes off. Do the kids look as if they're suffering? They're having a whale of a time. Look at them. We're as solid as that boulder over there. We always will be. If the business fails, then we'll start over again. We've both got the right attitude to make this the success it needs to be. Now, let's chat about the business. We're here to enjoy ourselves. How much farther do we have to go? My legs are killing me, and I'm starving." Malcolm glanced behind him. They were approximately halfway up the large hill. He cringed. "We've got a long way to go yet before we reach the top." She groaned. "Oh, I guess I'm not as young as I used to be." He roared with laughter. "You're 34, for God's sake, old woman my ass," he said, lowering his voice so the kids didn't hear him swear. "Okay, I'm not going to start an argument about this. I just want to enjoy our day out. Another few hundred feet up a steep climb isn't going to kill me, I suppose." She shuddered at the thought. She would need to dig deep to counteract the tiredness already seeping into her bones. "Want me to give you a shove?" "You might need to when we get near the top. Remind me, whose idea was this again?" "You mentioned going for a walk." "I picked the spot, though, as I recall." "There's a walk and a blooming mountain climb. I think this can be deemed the latter. Me and my big mouth. I much prefer looking at the Breckens from a distance rather than climbing the damn things." "Stop complaining. You're using up vital air. You'll need that when we get to the summit. The kids are fine. They're having a blast with Jasper." She couldn't argue about that. Half an hour later, they reached the summit. This hill was one of the smaller ones in the area, thank goodness. It was still a massive achievement to reach the top. They were all totally unfit. Well, she and Malcolm were anyway. The kids had oodles of energy and were still running around after Jasper. Malcolm turned 360 degrees, admiring the view, and pointed at the mountain in the distance. It's still my ambition to climb that one day, Penny Fan, the tallest peak for miles. Make sure that's a day when you don't have me tagging along, okay? Tina chortled. They spent the next couple of hours sharing the sumptuous picnic Tina had spent the previous day preparing, which included sandwiches, a tuna and pasta salad, and lots of different cakes, plus the odd piece of fruit thrown into the mix too. After eating, with her stomach bulging, Tina snoozed on the blanket for a few minutes before it was time to head back down to the car. One thing was for definite, they'd all sleep well tonight. Once they were all piled in the car, they drove the hour or so back home. Malcolm reached for her hand. Thanks for today. The food was amazing. Wasn't it? You don't have to thank me. It's always a pleasure looking after my family. They arrived home around 4. The kids had the audacity to put in a request to stop off for a Big Mac on the way. Not likely, you two, Tina said, shaking her head when she turned in her seat to face them. Marcus and Tallulah grinned.
Ha ha, got you, Mum. We're stuffed. I don't think I'll be able to eat another thing all week, Tallulah said.
Tina laughed. I'll hold you to that. They unloaded the car and settled down to watch Frozen. It wasn't long before both kids were asleep in the chair. She and Malcolm carried them upstairs and put them to bed and then returned downstairs.
Fancy a bottle of wine to finish off the perfect day?
Malcolm asked, hovering over her once she had collapsed into the sofa again. Her legs still felt a little wobbly from their adventure.
Why not?
They spent the next few hours with the TV switched off, chatting about the dreams they shared for the future and where they thought the business would lead them.
By the end of the second year, I foresee us having 20 trucks on the go, Malcolm said enthusiastically. Really? That many? And so soon? I love your optimism. I hope you're right. Maybe we'll be able to buy that quaint little cottage out in the sticks we've always dreamt about owning. Who knows?
The phone ringing interrupted their conversation. Malcolm reached over and dislodged it from its docking station.
Hello?
Tina tilted her head as he replaced the phone.
Who was it?
No idea. There was no one there.
A wrong number then, probably. I don't know about you, but I'm ready for the land of Nod. Gosh, I never thought I'd hear myself saying that at 9 o'clock. Let's finish off the bottle of wine in bed then, yeah?
He stood and yanked her to her feet.
I love you, Mrs. Webb. I still get shivers when I think of the time I almost lost you in that car accident a few years back.
His eyes watered. She ran her hand down his cheek.
You cared for me so well back then. I knew we'd be together forever, and that was before we were blessed with the children. Don't, I'm getting all emotional now. You know what I'm like when the tears start flowing.
He slipped his hand into hers and led her towards the stairs. She planted her heels in the carpet to object.
Wait, I need to check the back door is shut, and Jasper will need a wee before we bed down for the night. You take the wine and glasses, I'll be up in a second.
He stomped up the stairs, never one for being quiet around the house. It was his only floor. She let Jasper out and waited for her faithful companion to return. She topped up his water. He lapped half of it and then turned to walk through the house. He slept in their room on his own cot-sized mattress. He'd cried so hard when he was a pup being left alone downstairs that Tina had pleaded with Malcolm to bend the rules and allow him into the bedroom. That had been their undoing. He'd slept there ever since. She locked the back door and switched off the lights downstairs, her legs stiffening as she climbed the stairs.
Only a few more steps to go, then you can rest for 8 hours, I promise, she whispered.
She visited the bathroom, carried out her nightly routine, and then slipped into the bedroom. Malcolm was propped up against the pillows, his Tom Clancy novel spread out across his bare, hairy chest. She loved this man so much. Her heart still skipped several beats when she saw him half naked. Tina climbed into bed beside him and snuggled up.
Thank you for a lovely day. I feel so tired, I think I could sleep for a whole week.
Go to sleep then. I just want to finish this exciting chapter and then I'll switch the light off. Tina drifted off before he'd finished his sentence. He glanced up and saw the final light go out in the house. He'd leave it a while. It was still quite early to proceed with what he had in mind. He hunkered down in his seat, his balaclava in place already, surprised it wasn't irritating his cheeks. His gaze glued to the house in a trance-like state, until he noticed the clock on the dashboard read 5:30 a.m. He finally left the vehicle, taking his equipment with him. He was relieved there were no streetlights in the immediate vicinity to highlight his movements. Sprinting down the alley beside the semi-detached house, he entered the back garden, ensuring he closed the gate properly. He crouched low, then ran across the lawn to the back of the house. He stayed there, perfectly still, listening for any movements in the surrounding gardens. When he thought the coast was clear, he opened his hall-door and withdrew the small towel which he wrapped around his clenched fist. Within seconds, he'd punched a hole in one of the panes in the back door. He inspected his hand in the moonlight. Nothing, not even a slight graze. Replacing the towel in his bag, he slipped his hand through the hole he'd made, being extra careful not to cut himself on the remaining jagged glass still in position. He turned the key, opened the door and entered the house. His heart pounded like an African drum, so much so that his breath hitched a little. He inhaled and exhaled several times to calm himself, stood there a few seconds listening. Once he thought the coast was clear, he continued on his journey through the house, each step taking him an eternity to complete in his efforts to remain quiet. He was aware the family had a dog and was determined not to alert it. He placed his bag at the bottom of the stairs and withdrew another object, a can of petrol. He removed the lid inch by inch in his desire to keep the noise down. Then he went into the lounge. Fortunately, the door was still open. No chance of it squeaking when he entered the room. He poured some of the contents of the can over the sofa and the two armchairs and stepped back into the hallway. Then he tipped the can, aiming it at the front door, ensuring the family wouldn't be able to get out that way once the blaze took hold. He rattled the can, judging there to be around a third of the petrol left. Enough to do the bottom four or five stairs and the hallway going back through to the kitchen. In the distance, a noise rumbled. Was that the dog growling? He'd need to be quick. Dousing the stairs and the hallway, he retreated into the kitchen and threw the remains of the can over the back door. He placed the can in the bag, then ran back through the house and extracted the matches he had in his pocket. He lit the first one in the lounge, the next one at the front door, and the third one on the stairs as he retreated through to the kitchen, where he lit the final match. The flames were already licking up the furniture. The orange glow lighting the house had a satisfying effect on him. He picked up his bag and darted across the lawn and out the back gate. Making his way to the car, he glanced around him and grinned. Nothing. He had got away with it, feeling no remorse or regret. Maybe that would sink in over the coming days, but he doubted it.
That'll teach them. They shouldn't have done that to me. They're to blame, not me.
Chapter 1. The warming sun's rays seeped through the gap in the curtain and lit up Mark's face on the pillow next to her. All was good in Sara's life. It had taken a while to finally get to this point, surmounting various challenges, but her ambition had now been achieved. She smiled down at him and then kissed him gently on the lips. "Good morning, sleepyhead." He smiled, wrapped an arm around her waist and hugged her against him. She wagged a finger. "As much as I'd like to stay here all day, I can't. I have work to do. Actually, so do you. Haven't you got a new assistant starting today?" He scrubbed at his face.
"Oh, so I have. Why do the weekends whiz past and yet the week always drags?"
Sara laughed. "Speak for yourself. Every day speeds past for me. Too fast, in fact. I'll hop in the shower first."
"Oh, no. You can get that twinkle out of your eye. That's a shower for one on the agenda."
She kissed the tip of his nose and scooted out of the bed. Misty the cat was lying on the quilt at the bottom, and she stretched. Sara ran her hand down the length of her cat's body. Misty purred, her excitement clear. Yes, all is perfect in our world. The three of us have each other, and we couldn't be happier. Sara showered and cleaned her teeth, then withdrew her navy skirt suit from the wardrobe and slipped into it, adding the red blouse Mark had bought her the week before. He was such a thoughtful man, unlike any other she'd met. Well, except for the first love of her life, Philip. Every now and then she mourned his loss. However, the pain of losing him was getting less and less with each passing day, now that she had Mark and they had declared their love to each other. Mark swept past her and into the bathroom. She dried her hair and applied her makeup, then rushed down the stairs to see to Misty's needs. She was renewing the cat litter when Mark entered the kitchen, dressed in his jeans and a blue checked shirt. "It's all very well buying me a new blouse. When was the last time you spent any money on your own wardrobe?" "You're worth spoiling. I have enough clothes. What you're really saying is that you're bored of me wearing the same clothes all the time. I admit, it does get slightly monotonous. I forget and just grab the first thing I lay my hands on. It's a good job I wear a uniform, eh? I should say, your customers might be concerned otherwise. Did you say you'll probably be late tonight?" "Yes, I've got a tricky operation to do on a Doberman around 6 to try and fix his broken leg. It's going to be touch and go if I'll be able to save it or not. Super vet, I ain't. That miracle worker is giving us mere mortal vets a bad name. People watching his show think all vets can perform miracles like he can. Anyway, don't get me started on that. I should be home about 9. I'll let you know. How do you think your working day will pan out?" "Oh, my desk is relatively clear at the moment." She clicked her thumb and finger together. "But it can change just like that. We've had our share of tough cases to contend with as a team. We deserve a breather for a week or two." "Famous last words. You've probably tempted fate now. Want a piece of toast or do you have to shoot off?" "You see to the toast and I'll make the coffee. I've got 10 minutes before I have to leave. If I delay it any longer, I'm going to hit the traffic on the edge of town. I envy you having your surgery just up the road. You never get delayed on your way into work, do you?"
"Nope."
He tapped his forehead. "That was intentional. When I was on the lookout for a surgery, I ensured it was on the outskirts of town. Seems to have worked out for the best too. Hardly any of my clients miss an appointment or show up late. Clever dick. Unfortunately, the nick is in the heart of the city. I swear the traffic gets worse every damn day." She poured the boiling water over the coffee granules and sugar and added a splash of milk to the mugs just as the toast popped up for Mark to deal with. "Butter or marmalade on yours?" "I fancy butter this morning. I'll ring Mum tonight, invite us over there for Sunday roast. Are you up for that?" She saw Mark hesitate while buttering the toast. Placing a hand on his back, she asked, "What's wrong? Is it too soon?" "Let me think about it and get back to you tonight. Maybe it is too soon. I love spending time with you, being alone with you in the house. It's a safe environment." A smile touched her lips. "I get where you're coming from. They'll be gentle with you. You won't meet a more understanding couple, I promise you."
"Not that you're biased or anything."
He laughed and carried the plates over to the small kitchen table. "I suppose you're right. I'm guilty of wanting the world to know we're serious about each other. There's no better place to start than with our parents." He blew out a breath. "I know I don't talk about my parents much. It's not that I don't love them. I'm just not sure I'm ready to introduce you to them. Purely selfish reasons on my part." He covered her hand with his. "I accept that. Whenever you're ready to make the leap is fine by me. The next time I see Philip's family, I'm going to tell them about you. I've held off doing that up till now, not knowing how they'd take the news. But now, I want the bloody world to know we're together and in love."
"There's no rush.
I'll leave that side of things up to you. I'd prefer to leave my folks out of it for the time being. It's not as if we're in each other's pockets all the time. They're busy people and tend not to pester me, which suits me." She coughed to clear her throat. "Do they even know about me?" He hung his head in shame.
"Believe it or not, I'm a totally private person. Or should I say I used to be? So much has changed since I met you. Maybe, you know, me being abducted has changed my outlook on life, I don't know. Anyway, I'm happy to keep Mum and Dad at arm's length and things just the way they are. Let's just say they take a little getting used to. Now all that's done is alert my intrigue, Jean."
She finished off the last mouthful of toast and stood. "I've got to fly. Will you lock up for me?"
"Of course. You go. I'll see you later."
They shared another kiss. Sara grabbed her keys off the table and rushed into the hall to put on her shoes and coat, although she debated wearing the latter with the sun shining so brightly. She'd take it just in case, knowing how changeable the British weather could be. Sara arrived at the station just shy of 20 minutes later. She spotted her partner's car already in the car park. Nothing new there.
"Morning, Jeff. All quiet overnight?"
she asked the desk sergeant as she walked through the reception area. "There is a note on your desk." He raised his hand. "That's all I'm prepared to say, ma'am." Studying him closely, Sara noticed there were tears in his eyes. She didn't push the matter. Instead, she ran up the stairs two at a time and swept through the incident room into her office. She plucked the note from her desk and read it. A lump formed in her throat, and her own eyes misted up. She dropped her bag on the floor and returned to the incident room to address the team.
"Morning all. Not sure how aware you are of this."
She waved the note.
"Looks like we have an arson attack on our hands. Carla, are you ready to rock and roll? We should get over there ASAP.
Carla nodded but remained silent.
"I don't have to tell you guys what to do. Let's get the usual checks done on the property and its inhabitants. We'll be back soon to fill you all in."
Sara nipped into her office and picked up her handbag. Carla was waiting for her at the door, her head bowed, showing how upset she was at the thought of attending the scene. They left the room. Sara touched her partner's arm at the top of the stairs. "Are you all right?"
"I'm fine. Hate to be involved in such tragedies. Why wipe out a whole family like that?"
"That's what we've got to find out. Chin up, sweetheart." Carla walked down the stairs ahead of her, her shoulders slouched. Sara sighed. She wasn't looking forward to dealing with the case either, but she knew they had to put their own feelings aside for now and do the family justice. In the car, searching for a distraction after she keyed in the details to the sat-nav, she asked Carla, "I'm dying to hear how your date went on Saturday." Carla turned her way and raised an eyebrow.
"Do you think that's appropriate at a time like this?"
"Oh, okay. Slap me down for being an insensitive bitch, why don't you? Sorry, I'll concentrate on my driving instead."
"You do that," Carla snapped unnecessarily.
Sara wondered what was eating her partner, whether the case had already got under her skin or whether her date on Saturday had been a total disaster, and Carla was keen to avoid the topic. She'd keep her mouth shut instead during the 10-minute journey. The plumes of smoke could still be seen and appeared to be drawing them to the location.
"Crikey, this is a bad one."
Carla's head swiveled slowly to face her.
"Really? Is that the best you can say?"
"Whoa, don't take your foul mood out on me, missy.
I'm not. Just stating that you tend to come out with the obvious at times, that ticks me off."
Sara drew the car to a halt alongside the first fire engine. "You need to rein in that temper of yours, Carla. I'm not about to take any shit from you over this, got that?"
Carla heaved out a large breath and voiced a quiet apology.
"Sorry."
"What's going on?"
Carla tightened her hands into fists and repeatedly released and clenched them a number of times before she replied.
"Nothing. All's good with me and my perfect world."
"So your foul mood is personal then? Nothing to do with the fact that a family has been wiped out in this tragic event?"
"Your words, not mine. It has everything to do with this event."
"What? You're not making any sense. Spill." Carla reached for the handle and tried to get out of the car, but she'd forgotten to unclip her seatbelt.
"Damn!"
She banged against the headrest, defeated.
"What the fuck is your problem?"
"Nothing. Don't do this, boss. I'm fine. I'm dealing with it in my own way."
"Dealing with what? Jesus, tell me."
"My date on Saturday was going really well until..."
She gasped.
"No, he didn't try anything on. Did he lay a hand on you?
Well, get him if he did, I promise you. Will you listen for a change instead of jumping to conclusions?" "No, he was a perfect gentleman."
Carla stared off into the distance. Sara's gaze followed hers. She was transfixed by the fireman tackling the blaze.
"Then what?"
"He's one of them."
"No, he's gay?"
she asked, gobsmacked.
Carla faced her and shook her head. "Not one of them. One of them."
She pointed at the men holding the hoses.
Wow, he's a fireman. Sorry, I'm not with you. I don't see what the problem is.
It's a dangerous job. What if I fall for him and he ends up getting killed while he's trying to put out a fire?
Hello, news alert. You're a copper. That's an occupation that is ranked highly dangerous on the scale of jobs to avoid doing if you're of a nervous disposition too, in case you hadn't noticed.
Bugger, I know that. Shit. I knew I should have kept my mouth shut. Now you're going to think badly of me.
You talk a bucket load of crap at times, lady.
Do I?
Of course you do. You're looking for excuses not to enjoy life. Look, as much as I'd love to continue this conversation, now is not the time.
Sorry, you're right. I'm being a selfish cow as usual.
Sara left the vehicle and slammed the car door. You're not, so stop thinking that way. Carla joined her. They had their IDs in their hand and showed them to the uniformed officer manning the cordon. He held the blue and white tape up so they could duck under it. There was a SoCo team on site, and Sara spotted Lorraine, the pathologist, leaving her van. She headed that way to speak to her, noting that the fire appeared to be in its final stages now, thanks to the sterling work of the firemen on duty.
Lorraine, too early to tell us what you know, obviously?
Yep, not sure why I'm here, really. There's no way our guys will be able to get in there for at least a day or so. That'll be after the fire investigation team have done their bit. Shocking, all the same.
I know. Do we know anything about the family? Did anyone manage to get out?
Mother, father, and two kids aged 5 and 7. No humans made it out, but the dog over there was flung out the window by the father, so the neighbour said.
She pointed at a woman holding a leash with a cocker spaniel at the end.
How strange. Maybe the dog was in the bedroom with the husband and wife and they both went back into the house to rescue the kids and got trapped?
Possibly. My guess is when the husband opened the window, it fanned the flames and made the fire worse.
How terrible. Is the woman the neighbour?
The neighbour is the woman on the right. The one on the left is the mother of the woman who perished in the fire.
Shit, who called her?
Sara asked, staring at the distraught woman.
The neighbour. She got out as soon as she heard the screams going on next door and called 999 immediately. Her home has been affected by this too. Sod's law when you own a semi-detached, I suppose.
Bugger. Okay, I'm going to have a word with the man in charge. See what he can tell me.
Let me know what he says.
Sara and Carla approached a fireman who appeared to be dishing out the orders. Sara flashed her ID.
DI Sara Ramsey, SIO on the case. This is my partner, DS Carla Jameson. Can you give us a clue what's going on?
Mike Green, senior officer in charge. We've been tackling the blaze since around 6 this morning. Started down a couple of times, but started up again. One of my lads got in there. I wouldn't allow him to go too far, though. From the smell, he could tell an accelerant had been used.
Accelerant, such as?
Smelt like petrol. That's when I decided to call you lot in.
Thanks for that. There was no chance of getting in there to try and save the family then? I'm not judging you. Just asking the question.
It was raging out of control when we got here. Too dangerous for my men to go in there when an accelerant has been detected.
I get that. The poor family. Anything else you can tell me?
Nope. Only the basics until the fire investigator has been over the place.
Thanks. I'd better have a word with the neighbour and the mother then.
You do that,
he said, paying attention to the younger man who had approached him. Sara glanced at Carla and noticed her cheeks were as hot as the fire 30 feet away from them. She nudged her in the ribs and together they walked towards the two women she wanted to interview.
Was that him?
Carla nodded.
Yes.
Bloody hell, he's gorgeous. You need your head read, my girl, if you consider dumping him. That's all I'm going to say on the matter.
Carla laughed. Okay, I'll book an appointment with the shrink next week. How's that?
Do what you like. That'll be £100 wasted.
The two women were leaning against the wall of a neighbouring property staring at the house. They both appeared to be in shock.
Hi, I'm DI Sara Ramsey and this is DS Carla Jameson.
The woman wearing a pink velour dressing gown with rollers in her hair smiled briefly.
I'm Sylvia Trent. I live next door. My house has been affected too, but that doesn't matter. This is Tina's mother, Cynthia.
We believe Tina is still in there.
Her voice trailed off and she pointed a shaking finger at the burning house.
I'm sorry. It's a tragedy this has happened. I appreciate how upsetting this must be for you both. We need to ask a few questions, if that's all right.
Both women nodded.
Sylvia, we suspect the fire was deliberately started. Did you happen to see anyone suspicious hanging around the house before the fire began?
No. I've been in bed for hours. The shouting around 5:40 woke me.
She gulped and tears flowed down her cheeks.
I'll never forget their screams as long as I live. I'm sorry you had to hear that. You rang Cynthia, yes?
I rang 999 and then called Cynthia straight after. I knew she'd want to be here. That's right, love, isn't it?
She patted Cynthia's hand. The poor woman seemed lost, her gaze flitting between Sara, Carla and Sylvia, then back to the house.
Yes. My poor babies. What am I going to do without them? They were my life.
Is there anyone else we can call to be with you, Cynthia? Sara asked, a lump bulging in her throat.
They were the only family I had left. I lost my mother and father last year and now. Well, they've all been taken from me.
She broke down and sobbed. Sylvia cuddled her.
There, there. The police officers will find the culprits, love. Won't you?
She asked, glancing over Cynthia's shoulder. We're going to do our best. Did either your daughter or your son-in-law mention if they were having problems with anyone? Cynthia leaned back against the wall.
No. Nothing like that at all.
They got on with everyone. They were helpful, loved their family, always put the kids first. They just started up a new business. Maybe that will help?
Carla jotted down some notes without Sara needing to ask her to.
Perhaps. What type of business? Steam cleaning. They had big plans. We're going to grow the business quickly to employ more people.
How long has the business been up and running?
A week or two.
I see. And what did your daughter and son-in-law do for a living before that?
Tina worked on a production line at the local cake factory and Malcolm was a lorry driver. He was away from home a lot. That's why they saved up enough money to become self-employed. He felt he was missing out on seeing his family grow up and now this.
She shook her head, her eyes wide with disbelief.
Poor Jasper. He was the only one to get out. Well, they loved him. He was a treasured part of the family,
Sylvia said.
Malcolm must have thrown him out. He landed on the hedge. I rescued him and ran into the house to fetch one of my old leashes for him.
Sara looked down at the dog, which was sitting staring at the blaze.
Where will you stay, Sylvia? You'll probably be unable to access your house for a few days. She can come and stay with me, Cynthia replied. Jasper can come too. I won't see either of them out on the street.
Did your daughter mention if she'd seen anyone lurking around the house lately? Someone possibly following her, anything like that?
No, nothing. I can't believe anyone would go out of their way to deliberately hurt any of them.
Okay, we'll leave it there. I'll give you both a card. Ring me if anything comes to mind.
We will,
Sylvia said, taking both cards and thrusting them into her dressing gown pocket. Can you give Carla your address? We'll check in with you in a few days. Sara walked away from the group of people and turned to look at the fire. Then her gaze fell onto the bystanders. All neighbours? Or were they? Was the arsonist standing amongst them, admiring his work in a sadistic fashion? She'd organise house-to-house inquiry.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.